May is sitting down with the other EU leaders for what ought to be the final signing off of her Brexit exit. They have just endorsed it, and this should be a moment of triumph for the Prime Minister. Sadly for her, a moment only, because she now has to take it back to a truculent House of Commons. And then, well, keep watching. In this specially extended programme, fighting Theresa May's corner is the Foreign Secretary, Jeremy Hunt. And if she doesn't get the withdrawal agreement through Parliament, Arlene Foster, leader of the DUP, will be a big part of the reason why. If that happens, many people want Britain to be given another chance to vote on leaving the EU at all. Chief amongst them, the former Prime Minister, Tony Blair, who joins us live in the studio this morning. But Labour's official position is that they want another general election, and soon. Richard Burgon is the Shadow Justice Secretary, and he joins us from Leeds. Well, that's just about as much fun as you deserve. But I'm also joined by Bourne Ulvaeus to tell us the latest news as the great ABBA juggernaut thunders on. We're going to be played out by another music icon, Damon Albarn, and his band The Good, The Bad and The Queen. Half of a day to get over the waves you can. And today's news review comes from The Guardian writer Rachel Shabby, Andrew Pearce from The Daily Mail and Camilla Tominey, the associate editor of The Telegraph. Before all of that, however, the news with John Kay.
Thank you, Andrew. Good morning. The Prime Minister has arrived at a special summit in Brussels this morning to approve the Brexit agreement. After 18 months of negotiations, Theresa May and EU leaders are signing off the withdrawal agreement and the political declaration on future relations. Mrs. May has today published a letter to the nation to win public support for the deal. She says leaving the EU will mark a new chapter in the UK's national life and bring reconciliation after months of bitter battles. A man has been charged with the attempted murder of a police officer after a knife attack in East London. It happened at Ilford railway station on Friday night. Daniel Adeyemi, who's 24, will appear before magistrates tomorrow. The officer involved has been discharged from hospital. The French President Emmanuel Macron has criticised demonstrators who clashed with police in Paris overnight during protests about fuel prices. Officers used tear gas and water cannon to disperse demonstrators. 19 people were injured and 40 arrests were made. On Twitter, President Macron said, "Shame on those who attacked. There is no room for violence in the Republic." And South American football officials were forced to postpone one of the biggest matches in Argentina's history last night after a bus carrying one of the teams was attacked by rival fans. The game was between two teams from Buenos Aires, Boca Juniors and River Plate. Boca players suffered cuts from broken windows and were also affected by tear gas used by police. The match, which is the equivalent to the final of the Champions League, has been rescheduled to take place later today. That's it from me. The next news on BBC One is at 1 o'clock. Back to you, Andrew.
Many thanks, John. The papers feature the Prime Minister's open letter to Britain all over front pages. There's the Sunday Express, "Dear Britain, get behind my deal and we can get on with Brexit." There's the Observer, "May begs the public, unite behind me on the Brexit deal." And there is the Mail on Sunday, "PM's plea to the people, back my Brexit." But of course, life goes on and lots of people are looking beyond today to what happens next in the House of Commons and the likelihood of the deal being voted down. And the Sunday Telegraph, like other papers, a very interesting story about a secret plan B for Brexit, which is essentially a group of five cabinet ministers who want to push the Prime Minister into agreeing a kind of Norway-style EEA closer relationship with the EU if the deal is voted down. You see that again on the Sunday Times there on the front page. New gang of five in second cabinet mutiny on Brexit. And because they are very traditional, and this is a Sunday morning, there is a Tory sex story there as well. Lots and lots of other stories to talk about, but we will do lots and lots of Brexit, I think, today. Camilla, this letter, which is kind of unique, I think. I don't remember the Prime Minister writing ever an open letter to the people of Britain like this.
You'd be much better placed to comment than I would, Andrew, with your veteran experience. But no, I don't think we have heard of a letter like this. And the Mail on Sunday here has laid it all out and highlighted the relevant passages. It's interesting that she actually draws on quite an emotional argument, talking about how she's never lost sight of her sense of duty, that she will be campaigning with her heart and soul to win the vote. She even weaponises the quite controversial Brexiteer quote about the number on the bus, about an extra £394 million, so a bit more than the £350 million, that we'll have left to plough into the NHS.
For a Remain campaigner back in the day, she sounds very, very Brexity.
She does sound Brexity, but as Glen Owen and Harry Cole point out in the Mail on Sunday, I like the way they've put this, she will need a Houdini-like political skills to survive. And, of course, it's not just that she has to convince the country, but also her cabinet and also the Commons. And the consensus is the vote is not going to pass.
And the current figure, I think, is 91 Tory MPs are saying they're going to vote against it. So she just hasn't got the arithmetic.
OK, but the idea, can I just, you know, a tiny detail, the idea of the Prime Minister, the goal, the absolute goal of going to the country, this is the government that has divided the country with their horrible Brexit negotiations, with their horrible policies, from austerity to the hostile environment. You know, it took a UN expert on poverty to come to the UK and tell us not only how bad things are, but how absolutely in denial the government is over its own blame in that. And for the Prime Minister to then say, oh, will you all unite around our deal? Well, no, we can't. How can we possibly unite around the person that's divided us? It's impossible. It's absurd.
I think it's extraordinary, actually. Who would have thought, despite all the difficulties the Prime Minister's had, that there she is today signing this document, and we are now within touching distance of leaving the EU. And it was her job, Rachel, to do that, because she's Prime Minister.
She did it badly.
And there was a referendum, and she's done her best to enforce it. Now,
it's not like a mad computer game, isn't it? Yeah. No, she gets over one hurdle, jumps over one breach, there's another explosion, then she turns the corner, and there's more people shooting at her.
But we can now see it. We can almost touch it now, that we're nearly out of the
EU. But the other argument, again, is to say that the Brexit vote indicates that we've always been divided on Europe. And, in fact, we've always been divided politically. There are some on the left and some on the right. Yeah. So this whole idea that any deal could stop division, people were always going to be believing in their own thing. We've been split for decades. Why should it be any different in this future?
And the vote in the referendum was 52 to 48, and she's tried to accommodate all sides.
Let's return to the papers. In terms of the pro-Brexit sentiment, there is one key text, I think, in today's papers, which is Martin Howe, QC, in the Sunday Telegraph.
Yeah, he's part of Lawyers for Brexit. He's a long-serving Tory party supporter. But whereas the letter of the Prime Minister's writing is appealing to the country to get behind her, he's written a devastating critique of her negotiating style. He says, when it comes to caving into EU demands, Theresa May is as flexible as a limp lettuce. And there's much more language of the sort. He goes on about Spain now can't wait to plunge the knife in at the point when it will have legal veto over the UK escaping from the backstop. He hates this backstop, which is what the Tory Prime Minister has agreed to, and the EU are the only ones who say when we can leave it.
I find it very hard to work out whether the government has actually conceded anything real over Gibraltar or not. I don't know if anybody has a view on that.
Not sure. Yeah. She says, I stick with Gibraltar to the
very
end.
Very forcibly.
Exactly. Mm. But others are saying she's surrendering too much. But that's been the story of the referendum from beginning to end, Andrew.
Well, also, it's indicative of some of the constructive ambiguity going on.
Yes.
That one single document can be interpreted in such an extreme way by both sides.
Rachel Shabby, the Gang of Five story is the one that takes us furthest forward in the news this morning, isn't it?
Yeah, she's apparently, what you were saying earlier is true. She's got plotters to the right of her and plotters to the left of her in her own party. Now it seems that she's got a fresh Gang of Five in the second cabinet mutiny. This is coming from Remain ministers.
Led by Philip Hammond, the Chancellor.
Led by Philip Hammond and including Amber Rudd, who want to try and soften the deal. But this actually speaks to the absolute chaos in the government. They are hopelessly, intractably divided over Brexit. They cannot negotiate a Brexit deal with the EU because they cannot negotiate a Brexit deal with themselves. Well, that was always the problem from the start to the finish. They've signed a deal that her own government, her own party doesn't like and is going to vote down.
And everybody from both sides
is saying, that's a built-in problem with a Conservative government. That's not going to change.
I mean, part of the problem is everyone is saying, we can tweak it this way or tweak it that way. As of this morning, it's too late to tweak it. It's been a speech.
It's legally binding. That's it.
And also there's been this discussion about the fact that the deal itself is legally binding, but the 27-page document of our future declaration isn't, and yet that's the one that makes some of the concessions. Yeah. So it's confusing. It's interesting, though, this whole talk of EEA has rumbled.
Yeah.
And there may be more cabinet consensus over an EEA-style approach, just because we've heard figures like Michael Gove, traditionally regarded as a Brexiteer, being aligned to it. So is that where they can find common ground?
And it was Nick Bowles, the Tory MP, he wrote it in the Mail, actually, arguing for a Norway-style solution.
Yes, but becoming more popular.
It is becoming more popular, but the one problem will be for a lot of people, it would mean we do not get rid of free movement of people straight away, and that is a red line for many people.
Rachel, lots of other political stories related to this. A lot of people are still hoping for another referendum on that. And there's an interesting story in one of the papers about talks between the so-called People's Vote campaign and the Labour leadership, because Jeremy Corbyn has always been very, very cautious about this new referendum idea. He's looking to all the pro-leave Labour voters in the north, I suspect.
So this story is about John McDonnell, the Shadow Chancellor, being in secret talks with the people who are organising around a public vote. Now, if true, it would kind of make sense. Now, you can see why Labour is sticking to its own sequencing over Brexit. If you were the opposition, you would, and you were the Labour Party, you would want to vote down the withdrawal deal because it's rubbish. You would want to then eliminate through Parliament any chances of a no deal because that's ludicrous, and then you would want to have an election. Of course, if you're the Labour Party, you want not just to negotiate a better Brexit, but you want to alleviate some of the inequalities and the hardships that they're not the only reasons for Brexit, but they definitely have affected the vote. So of course you're going to want to do that. That's the logic of being the Labour Party. But it might then be, if the only remaining option to get out of this situation is a public vote, then there is a built-in problem with that sequencing, even though it makes sense. The built-in problem is that you have not prepared the ground. You have not advocated. You have not explained why it's necessary to have a public vote. You haven't talked to your own Labour Leave voters about that. So that's the problem with this particular sequencing.
Isn't it also a problem that McDonnell and Corbyn are both staunch Brexiteers?
Of course.
They both voted to remain.
This is Marxism, except it's Groucho. Here are my principles, and if you don't like them, here are some others. It's a party management exercise.
This is just ridiculous ambushing of a perfectly logical argument,
Rachel,
which I just presented to you.
McDonnell and Corbyn. McDonnell and Corbyn are aligned on their Euroscepticism with the likes of John Redwood.
They may be quite shrewd aware of the very, very large number of Labour voters, particularly in the North and the Midlands, who are pro-Brexit.
Jeremy Corbyn's only aware of the fact that Leave won. Yeah. So if you want to do something else, you have to get a mandate for it and you have to persuade your own people. Okay.
Well, if Leave won, why would you try to undo the vote?
Interestingly, on the referendum, Diane Abbott said only the other day, a key ally of Jeremy Corbyn, she thinks if there is a second referendum, Leave will win with a bigger margin.
I think she's
probably right.
In all of these shenanigans, people are falling out with each other and shouting at each other. But there's a rather sweet story in the Sunday Times about a rapprochement.
Peter Mandelson, the architect of New Labour, you've got the champion of New Labour on the programme later, Tony Blair, has been bonding with Jeremy Corbyn's enforcer, Seamus Milne. He's his media man. They've been having secret meetings, secret talks. Remember, Peter Mandelson said, I wake up every day with one ambition, to undermine Jeremy Corbyn every single day. So here he is breaking bread with Seamus Milne, who is the eyes and ears of Jeremy Corbyn.
Absolutely fascinating. Thanks all very much for that. Before I speak to my first guest, let's go over to our political editor, Laura Koonsberg, with the latest from Brussels right now. Laura, you're standing outside the building. What's happened so far?
Well, Andrew, after 18 months of coming to these Brussels summits saying, can a deal be done? No, it can't. Yes, it can. Maybe. Who knows? It is done. In the last 15 minutes, the 27 European leaders have signed off that withdrawal agreement, the divorce deal, and the political declaration, that sketched out relationship for how things will be between the UK and the rest of the continent for decades to come. And Theresa May has just arrived. Now they've signed it off with a big rubber stamp to get this whole process going. What's been really interesting, I've been talking to EU leaders as they were arriving before their meeting this morning, every single one of them sticking to the same script. This is as good as it gets. Now over to Britain's MPs.
I guess one of the obvious questions is for all those people at home who've been saying from the left and the right, we could accept this if you make one more tweak. It's now too late for any tweaks. Is that right?
It's in black and white. I mean, the deal has been done. But remember, there is in the political declaration that sketched out skeleton, if you like, for how things are going to be in the years to come. There's a lot still that is open there. It could be, over years to come, designed to make us being in a very, very close relationship with the EU, something like, you know, best friends and neighbours and almost still living in each other's pockets. Or it could end up with a deal for decades to come that's something much looser. Respectful neighbours doing business together, but pretty distinct and pretty separate. But in terms of the deal, what is going to be on paper in these next few critical political weeks in terms of it getting through Parliament or not, yeah, that is done. That is over. It is now there in black and white. However, do not underestimate the capability and potential for the government to come out with the odd little thing here and there at home in order to try to ease its passage through Parliament in the next couple of weeks. You know, I wouldn't be that surprised if we might see the odd thing, a clarificatory note perhaps, a little bit of extra information here, a little extra assurance,
yeah.
Maybe something for the DUP, maybe something for Brexiteers. As one member of the Cabinet joked to me last week, you can do a lot with addenda, but in terms of the formal script from Brussels,
That's it. It
is done, at least for now.
Well, you've got a very, very long day ahead of you. For now, Laura Koonsberg, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. And I'm joined now. The government's majority depends, of course, on Northern Ireland's DUP, as you know. They are livid about the agreement Theresa May is currently signing off in Brussels. They want to help vote it down while keeping Mrs. May's government alive. And that is not a terribly easy circle to square. Arlene Foster, the DUP leader, is here now. Arlene Foster, welcome.
Hi.
Are there any circumstances in which you would vote for this deal?
No. There aren't, because the withdrawal agreement, which has been ratified this morning, has a very large section in it, the Irish Protocol as it is known, which is legal text, an internationally binding treaty, which makes a difference between Northern Ireland and the rest of the UK.
For people watching at home, they might be slightly confused because Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland are already in a single electricity deal. And perhaps more to the point, when livestock is moved from Britain into Northern Ireland, it's checked. I mean, there are veterinary checks, there are physical checks, there are paper checks. And all this is saying is that there are going to be further regulatory checks. Isn't there already a border down the Irish Sea?
No, there isn't. Those are very sensible checks that have been agreed between all of the parties. What we're seeing in this Irish Protocol is much more than that. We're seeing us staying within the European Union in terms of the single market. The customs union rules will apply to Northern Ireland. We're in the same VAT regime as Europe. We're in the same state aid as Europe. And there is very much a border down the Irish Sea as a result of this, and that's why we can't support this deal.
But the new regulations that are proposed are only for things like processed food. So it sounds like regulations for cows are all right, but regulations for Ulster fries and sausages are not all right.
No, it's much more than that. It's manufactured goods and agricultural products as well. And one of our concerns, one of our real concerns, apart from the fact of the constitutional piece, which of course is very important to us, is that this is going to add cost to the consumers in Northern Ireland as well, because there are going to be more regulatory checks on the goods that come from GB into Northern Ireland.
You've already got a very different society in Northern Ireland in some respects from the rest of the UK. When it comes to gay marriage, when it comes to abortion and other things, you are a different society already. Is this change so big that it's worth bringing the house down?
Well, I'm very glad you asked me that, actually, because, of course, those matters are devolved to Northern Ireland to make decisions on. But international trade, customs, the single market, those things stay at Westminster. Those things are kept in the National Parliament. And what this document does, what the international treaty, which has just been agreed today, does, is make a difference between us in terms of those international issues. And I think that is very important for us.
So that's why you want to vote it down. If you're unsuccessful, if Theresa May gets this withdrawal treaty through the House of Commons, what happens to your supply and confidence agreement that you've got with her?
Well, as far as I can see, there doesn't seem to be a great deal of enthusiasm in the House of Commons for this deal. In fact, quite the contrary. So let's wait until we get to that vote. I don't see any circumstances at present where that vote will be able to go ahead in Theresa May's favour. So then we will have to go back. And what we've been saying and what I said at my conference yesterday is, why waste time? Why not look for a better deal now instead of wasting time and having to do that after the vote is taken?
I guess what I'm trying to get to is your deal with Theresa May to support her government still live?
Oh, it is still live, but you should remember also that the deal was signed to deliver on Brexit and to do that in a way that had shared principles between the Democratic Unionist Party and the Conservative Party. But, of course, the reality is there are many in the Conservative Party who don't like what's on the table today either.
And so at what point would it expire, that agreement?
Well, I think, and I've said this before, if it came to the situation that Parliament did decide, and there's no evidence that they're going to, but if they did decide to back this deal, then obviously we would have to review the confidence and supply agreement.
Can I ask, you say you'd have to review it, can I ask that if that happened, and who knows what's going to happen, the whips are working very hard, it's a very fluid situation, if she gets this through, do you end that agreement?
Well, I have just said we'll review the agreement at that point in time because, as you've just said, things are very fluid, things change. We have to see where we are when that vote is taken. I don't believe currently, given everything that is happening, that she will get support for that. I know she's going over the heads of people and she's doing that in Northern Ireland as well. But as far as I can see, in Parliament, she does not have support for this deal.
Because one of the things that's being speculated about in the papers today is that if she takes it to the House of Commons and loses, she almost immediately holds a confidence vote in her government. And then her future is in your hands immediately, which is why I'm pressing on this. Do you then support her?
Well, we will have to see what happens at that time. I mean, I think this last couple of weeks should tell all of us that we shouldn't jump ahead of ourselves. What we should do is wait and see what develops in that
respect. So you can't guarantee...
We will not... What I can guarantee to you is, if this is what's coming, and it looks very much like this is what's coming to Parliament, we will not be able to support that deal.
So we know what's coming. You won't support it. And in those circumstances, you'll be taking us logically and inevitably closer to no deal. That's a huge risk for the DUP, isn't it?
No, I don't accept that at all, because even if we got to the situation where Europe was refusing to negotiate further, there will then have to be a lot of bilateral deals and a lot of very meaningful things, not just for the UK, but for Europe as well. So I believe we should use the time now to look for a third way, a different way, a better way. Look, Andrew, I recognise negotiating fatigue. I recognise that more probably than anybody, that there comes a time when everybody's very tired, everybody just wants to get it done, but we shouldn't just accept an outcome for the sake of it. We should try and get a deal that is good for everybody.
You are voting down the only deal that's on the table.
Presently.
And the bedrock of DUP supporters, the small businesses, the farmers across Northern Ireland, are horrified by that. They're really, really worried. Let me read you what the Ulster Farmers Union says. We want to make sure we avoid a no-deal situation. No deal for Northern Ireland, agri-food and farming in particular, would be absolutely disastrous. And they also say the sheep farming industry would be finished in those circumstances.
We're not advocating a no-deal. We're advocating a better deal, and we've said that consistently, and I will keep saying that because that is what I want to see achieved. Theresa May knows that she is not going to currently get this deal through Parliament, so let's get a better deal and let's not close our ears and close our eyes to what's going on around us.
Well, let's keep my big ears open to the various possibilities ahead of us, one of which, of course, is discussed in this paper, the so-called Gang of Five cabinet ministers, who are talking about a more Norway-style arrangement instead of this deal. And it said the DUP are part of those conversations, are you?
Well, there are conversations going on right across government.
I
don't think that will surprise you. We're talking to everybody across government. We're talking to people in the Remain side. We're talking to Brexiteers. We're talking to everyone, as I think you would expect us to do.
So you want a better deal. What could come? What would change your mind and lead you to support a deal?
Well, there's a range of issues. First of all, we want to see the Irish backstop gone. If everybody is committed to no hard border in on the island of Ireland, Leo Varadkar has said it, Theresa May has said it, Europe has said it. Who's actually going to put this hard border in place? Sure. There is no need for the Irish backstop, so let's get rid of it. If people are saying, no, we want to keep the Irish backstop, let's have a look at an exit clause then. Where is the exit clause that we were promised? It's not there.
They've been trying for 18 months to find a way around this Irish backstop, and they've failed again and again and again. Theresa May and the EU both say that we don't expect or want or hope to get into the Irish backstop situation. So this is something that might happen but probably won't.
Yeah. It's a legally binding text, Andrew. And really and truly, you can't have it both ways. You can't say it's not going to happen, so don't worry about it, and then on the other hand, sell it as the best of both worlds. there's been an inherent contradiction with that argument. Either it's there and it's in the text and it may come, which of course is what I believe, and that would be wrong, and it would be wrong for Northern Ireland from a constitutional point of view and from an economic point of view.
Could you live with EEA membership, so-called Norway style membership?
Well, we've always been very keen to give the government the space to negotiate a deal in terms of Brexit. That's the way we've always operated. But the one thing that we could not have was a difference between us and the rest of the UK in terms of international trade, in terms of customs, and in terms of regulations.
So if we were all inside the EEA but not the EU, that would actually answer most of your problems, wouldn't
well,
it?
Well, I'm not going to be prescriptive with the government. What I'm saying to the government is this deal, this current deal, does not allow us to take back control, certainly not in terms of Northern Ireland, because we stay within the European Union structure, and we will have no say on those rules. We will have a democratic deficit. We have to take the rules, but we've no way of influencing those.
Has Theresa May let you down?
Well, we're disappointed with the way in which this has progressed, I have to say. I know, look, I really do understand that she is a unionist, she wants to get the best deal, but actually what this deal does is go against everything that she said around all of that.
See, there's a lot of people in the Tory party who accept that you're going to vote against this particular deal, but think beyond that, you will stick with the Conservatives, come what may. It's all bluster, it's all mouth and no trousers. You huff and you puff, but you'll never blow their house down because you couldn't possibly be associated with Jeremy Corbyn coming into number 10. You couldn't be allied with Labour, and therefore, in effect, they're safe with you. Whatever you say, they're safe.
Well, there is a matter of the Fixed Term Parliament Act, Andrew, and I think
there
when
is,
people talk about Jeremy Corbyn coming straight in if we don't support this deal, there's been a lot of project fear involved in
I'm
all
sorry,
of this.
That is exactly my point.
Yes.
You don't support the deal, but you don't allow the circumstances in which we could lose this House of Commons, or there could be an election, or maybe even a second referendum.
Well,
in other words,
I actually believe, Andrew, if we support this deal, then what you will see is those 17.4 million people who voted to leave in a meaningful way will say, why did we support the Conservative Party? Why did we support the Conservative Party to deliver on this deal when they're clearly not? And they will ensure that Jeremy Corbyn is in power, not us. They will ensure that he's in power, and I think
but
that is a very key issue.
Meanwhile, you keep them in power. It's like that old poetry line, thou shalt not kill, but needst not strive officiously to keep alive. You're going to keep alive this Conservative government for as long as you possibly can.
As I think I've said to you, we will review after the vote. I don't believe that that vote is going through Parliament, so we're talking a lot of hypotheticals at the moment. But what we must do is get to the next stage. The next stage is the meaningful vote, and if she doesn't succeed in that, then we will look to a better way and a third way.
Do you think she's finished if she loses that vote?
Well, that's not a matter for me. That's a matter for her own party.
Arlene Foster, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. Weather, horrible. Over to Alina Jenkins in the Weather Centre. Alina.
Hello there, Andrew. Yes, showers and a cold wind, never a good combination. But at least there's some brighter skies around today compared to the grey and gloomy skies of yesterday. We've still got some showers, though, feeding in on that brisk easterly wind, particularly for eastern coast. Some of those are getting a little bit further westwards. The showers that we've got across Kent and Sussex will tend to dissipate, so a drier afternoon here. Some bright or sunny spells, the best of these across western side of Scotland, but a cold-feeling day in the breeze, highs between 7 and 9 Celsius. Still some showers around through this evening, particularly for northern England along eastern coast. Elsewhere, some clearer skies. And where we see those clearer skies across Scotland, Northern Ireland and northern England, we could well see a widespread frost as temperatures in more rural areas get close to freezing. So wherever you are, it's a chilly start to the new week, but a fairly quiet day. There's some bright or sunny spells, variable, often large amounts of clouds. Still some showers, chiefly for eastern coast, but most having a mainly dry day. Still on the cold side, though, highs between 6 and 9 Celsius. But then we see some changes, something we've not seen for a while. An Atlantic front pushing its way eastwards as we go into Tuesday. Notice the squeeze in the isobars, so some quite windy and wet conditions arriving into western areas through Tuesday morning. We could see some snow for a time across the hills of northern England and into Scotland thereafter. Windy but milder next week.
Thanks very much. The campaign to have another EU referendum, which calls itself the People's Vote, has been gathering pace. Among its leading supporters is the fervent pro-European, the former Prime Minister, Tony Blair. Mr. Blair, can I start by suggesting you have always been a pragmatic politician. You're a pragmatist, you're in favour of life and business basically carrying on. This deal ensures that goods carry on flowing without tariffs. The one thing that people voted for in the referendum, which is an end to free movement, happens. In many ways, life for most people, if this went through, would feel very much the same. So why are you so against it?
I'm against it because the whole basis of Theresa May's case to the British people is that this honours the Brexit mandate and it settles the issue.
Yeah.
and actually neither is correct. It doesn't honour the Brexit mandate because the people who most fervently believe in Brexit say this isn't Brexit. And it doesn't settle the issue because actually there's so much still to be discussed that even those people who stay in the cabinet at the moment, who are really anti her plan but stay in it tactically, want to pull us the other side of March 2019 and carry on the fight. And therefore, the only way you're going to unite the country ultimately is to get this back to the people and say you've got a mandate whether the government does a proper Brexit, that's the sort of Brexit that Boris Johnson wants, or that we stay. And that is, you know, the only way of resolving this now, because I think her deal will fail because in the end it will satisfy no one. It's actually only succeeded in uniting people in opposition to it.
So you want to take it back for another referendum. Can I put it to you, it's a bit like that glorious day for you in 1997. You've been elected Prime Minister, you're in your limousine, you're on your way to Downing Street, and the police knock on the door and say, I'm terribly sorry, we've had a discussion and we're going to rerun the election. You'd have been absolutely horrified and outraged. And that's what Brexit voters feel like when people suggest rerunning the referendum.
OK, but here's the other thing that Brexit voters feel, and it's a bit like me having come in as leader of the Labour Party and then suddenly decided I've become a Conservative, right? That the issue for the Brexit people is precisely the reason why we should go back and put it to the people for a final vote. Because the very people who agitated most strongly for Brexit are now saying, this isn't Brexit. And therefore, literally, why are we doing it? We're not doing it to satisfy them, and it obviously doesn't satisfy people like me. And the reason the government is in this position, it's really important we understand this. All the way through, the problem has been very simple. For 4.5 decades, Britain has been trading in Europe. You've grown up with these intricate supply chains for manufacturing industry. You've got a financial service sector that allows us to be outside the euro, but still the financial centre for the euro. You've got all sorts of things like cheap air travel, mobile telephony. All of these things have developed as part of Europe's single market. So the problem for the government...
English in particular have never been ruled by anybody else.
Yes, but... And not, by the way, now, I would say. But if you take the Brexit argument, they want to get out of all those rules. So your dilemma is this. You either get out of the single market, in which case you're going to do economic damage, at least in the short and medium term. That's the painful Brexit. But if you don't, and you do what Theresa May wants, which is stay tied to Europe's rules, this is what the Chequers document says, then you're in a pointless Brexit. So your choice is between painful and pointless. And that's the reason why we've had a problem all the way through. And the Northern Ireland issue, by the way, is just a metaphor for the whole problem. Because if you want a frictionless border in Ireland, you've got to stay in the single market and the customs union.
OK, let's return to the referendum idea. This can only happen if MPs vote for it.
Yeah.
Do you think there's really a majority in the House of Commons for another referendum?
Not yet, but I think it'll get there. And it'll get
How will it get there? Because, I mean, there's talk in the paper today of the People's Vote campaigners talking to the leadership of the Labour Party about the Labour... Because it really will only happen if the Labour Party whips its MPs to make it happen. And there's no sign of that at the moment.
Well, I think it's moving that way. I would be really surprised if the Labour Party doesn't end up in the position of supporting another vote, because there's no other proposition that can get through Parliament, by the way. People aren't going to vote for this deal because it's, I'm afraid, a bad deal.
You could see a collapse and a general election, couldn't you?
I think it's highly unlikely the Conservative Party will want to have a general election. I mean, if the Conservative Party had a general election with Brexit unresolved, it really would be a suicidal act. Now, you know, politics is politics today, so heaven knows, but I doubt that's going to happen. So I think I can't quite specify exactly how it happens in parliamentary procedure, but I think when you start to exclude all the other possibilities, you're really left in the end with that one.
Well, let's return to this crucial question of what Labour might do, because it might be said that Jeremy Corbyn, and you disagree with him about almost everything, on this, he may be wiser. He's been on the fence on the referendum issue very, very uncomfortably but carefully for a long time, because he understands the very, very large number of Labour voters, particularly in the northeast of England and the east of England, which you used to represent, really, really care about Brexit, want it to happen, and if he goes against them, he may lose all of those seats. Therefore, he's been playing a very clever long-term balancing act, and I don't see why he suddenly comes off the fence at this point.
Right, so here's why I think he does. I mean, I completely get it. If you're in a heavily Leave seat and you're a Labour MP, you're worried that if you vote... Right. But these people who voted for Brexit, if they think what they're getting is not really Brexit, How are you appeasing them or making them happier because you're voting for Theresa May's deal? Mm. And this is why I say the central question here is, if it's not a deal that satisfies the people who voted for Brexit, why on earth are we doing it? I mean, just roll around your mind.
Okay, I get that.
Yeah, but here's the point. If it isn't what those people who voted Brexit really want, why are we doing it?
Because people voted for something, and this is something, basically.
But it's not what they voted for. And that's why I say to you, the curious thing is people say, well, look, if you have another referendum, you're going to divide the country. Mm. It's the opposite. And I'll tell you why.
I want to come directly onto that, because the first referendum was an incredibly divisive moment for the country. Everyone got very, very angry. One MP was killed as a result. People got incredibly inflamed. And if you go back and you run it all again for month after month after month, don't you look at the prospect of that with some horror, what it will do, dividing families, dividing communities, dividing the country?
OK, so take the two scenarios. You go ahead with what we've got. We don't really know what we're voting for. The meaningful vote in Parliament, I literally don't know how the government say they've got something meaningful for Parliament to vote on when you read that political declaration. We're going to be kept in the customs union until Europe allows us out of it. If Chequers goes forward, we're going to be tied to Europe's rules but having lost our say. I think this is a kind of botched Brexit. If you do that, the other side of March 2019, you're just carrying on this fight. Okay. If, on the other hand, people like me who voted Remain feel, OK, we've had 2.5 years of trying to make this thing work. We now, instead of claim and counterclaim, have real facts we can debate. We would feel satisfied by having another opportunity to
even
put
if
our
you
case.
Lost.
Even if we lost, and I'll come to that in a minute because it's very important. And the people who voted Leave can actually put forward, and everyone would accept, this is real Leave. If you're going to vote Leave, you have real Leave.
If it went your way, why would you not have another referendum after that? Best of three, best of five, best of seven.
So here's the other thing that should happen. Both the Remain campaign and the Leave campaign should jointly agree that this vote is final. Doesn't matter how marginal it is, it's final. Once this is resolved, then that's it for a generation. And I would feel we'd had the opportunity to make our case, so I would feel better about it. And these Leave people who think this is a botched Brexit that isn't really Brexit, they would also feel better about it.
We were told the last one was final.
Yes, but here's the problem. Since then, we've had 2.5 years of negotiation, and we've discovered there are many varieties of Brexit. So this is why, in the end, I know it sounds hard.
What would the question be? Would it be Remain, Leave with a so-called hard Brexit, or something like the Prime Minister's deal? Because you'd have to give people a range of options,
right,
wouldn't you?
Right. So you've got two options on this, and I'll tell you which one I prefer. Option one is you go Remain or the Boris Johnson version of Leave, because that's what the Brexit people really want. Option two is you have three offers. You can do Remain, the Boris Johnson Brexit, the Theresa May Brexit. I personally think the first is simpler. You take the two propositions that actually have public support, and you put it to the British people. If you do that, and it's a final say, and both campaigns agree this is it, whatever way we vote, that's it. And I promise you this, for people like me who voted Remain, if the country votes again to leave...
You accept.
I accept it, and I'll get behind it and try and make it work.
About a year ago, or 6 months ago, there was an awful lot of talk about Labour had gone to the left. There was a huge number of voters left in the centre of British politics. There's going to be a remaking of British politics, a new party. Perhaps you were going to be involved, perhaps you weren't going to be involved. Money was being raised. That's all over, isn't it?
No, I think it's not all over. I mean, I'm not involved in it myself, but I think if you have a very left-wing Labour Party and you have a Brexit-dominated Conservative Party, you leave a big space in the middle. But I think, frankly, that, for the moment, is for another day.
Right.
I think right now what people realise is that Brexit's the issue and you've got to focus on that.
OK, you are one, I think, of four living people who have done Theresa May's job. I just wondered, putting the politics to one side, what you make of her at the moment. Every day she gets up and she's assailed again by criticism from every single side. It may feel slightly familiar. Goes into the House of Commons for kind of crucial votes. There's cabinet revolts back behind her. What do you make of her performance as a practicing politician looking at another?
As a person, I have a lot of respect for it. I think she's shown resilience. I think she's shown a degree of courage and standing up and getting on. And, you know, she's a decent person, frankly, surrounded by a lot of pretty unreasonable ones. The problem is, having said all that, the deal's a dodo. So this is the difficulty that she has. But in personal terms, you know, I've done the job, I know how difficult it is. I really, you know, I respect the fact she manages to stand up and get on with it. I think that's a great capability, a great characteristic. Yeah, she is, and this is not a personal thing. Personally, I actually, I can see a lot to admire in the way that she handles herself. It's that literally this is the destiny of our country, and it's the wrong decision for our country. Right. And this is why we have to resolve it finally through the people.
Tony Blair, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. Now, if you want real staying power as a pop music phenomenon, one clever thing to do, it seems, is to split up and stop performing. It's 26 years since ABBA last performed together in public, but their reputation and their sales have never been higher. After the two big Mamma Mia films, their latest exploit involves inviting people round for dinner. ABBA's Bjorn Ulvaeus is here in the studio this morning to tell us more about the party he is throwing. Yeah. Literally, people turn up and they go into a Greek taverna. What happens next?
It is. I've always thought that there is a party mood in the whole Mamma Mia thing.
It certainly is, so, yes.
And I'm pretending, this is an experiment, really, a very exciting one. I'm pretending to take a Greek taverna from the island of Skopelos, where the exteriors of the first movie were filmed, and I'm bringing it to the O2 with fountains, olive trees, bougainvillea, and the whole thing. And every night there, you eat, you drink, and there's a real-time story going on between Nikos, who is the host, and his friends and family.
So it's a bit like being almost on the set of the film. It's not cheap, though, is it? The tickets are 150 quid or something.
But, I mean, people stay there for 3-4 hours, and they get everything, a whole night out.
Tell us about... There's a new song that ABBA have composed and are going to perform through avatars, I think.
Yes, yes.
Tell us about that.
We're in a project where we're creating like digital twins of ourselves, version 1979, roughly thereabouts.
When you were your finest, do you think?
Well, the ladies seem to think that they were the finest back then. And we've written a new song and recorded that, and this will be sung by these digital twins. It's been delayed. It was supposed to be released this autumn, but probably in the beginning of next summer.
So that was ABBA at their finest. And we always like having rock and pop musicians on the show, particularly when they have intervened in our national political life, as you have. Let's just take a little look at this. Did you see that at the time?
I saw it, yes, I did. It made the news, even in Sweden.
What did
and,
you think?
And like Tony Blair was saying, I think she was very brave in doing that.
She was it's taking kind the of mickey touching. Out of herself,
it's, basically. It's, you know, a lady with not a lot of rhythm in her, you know, braving and doing something like that. I was kind of touched, actually.
Mm. I was talking to Benny, your colleague, a little while ago, and he was saying he was very upset about Brexit. He felt personally hurt and upset about Britain leaving the EU. I wonder, do you feel the same?
Well, that was my initial feeling too, like a friend not wanting to be a friend anymore. Mm. But we've come a long way since then, and I've come to realise that, you know, Britain will always be Britain, whatever happens.
And in terms of the future of the ABBA phenomenon, we've had two films. Just tell us a little bit about how those avatars, they're like kind of, they're versions of yourselves produced by lighting in 3D. How's that going to work?
They will be like libraries of face muscles. They will be zeros and ones. They will be our cyber twins. And they will be able to do anything and sing anything and do anything. I'll be a street dancer if I want to. I couldn't back then, but now.
So you can do anything you like. It was a very, very good idea to split up back then and stop performing because it gives you a much longer shelf life afterwards.
It's so
strange
it seems,
world
so it
we live
seems.
In.
It's very strange, but I'm grateful and humbled by it.
Bjorn, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. Now a look at what's coming up on the Sunday Politics, where you are, straight after this programme.
In London, a row over the future of St Helier's Hospital in southwest London. A&E and maternity services are to be moved. What will that mean for local people? And the number of suicides among prisoners this year has already exceeded last year's death toll as the crisis of overcrowding and mental illness in our prisons reaches breaking point.
Richard Burgon, the Leeds East MP, is a rising star on Jeremy Corbyn's front bench. With all eyes on how Labour MPs will vote, the Shadow Justice Secretary joins me now from Leeds.
Morning, Andrew.
Good morning, Richard. Can I ask you, first of all, the deal has now been signed. It's done. It's over. What happens next from Labour's point of view?
Well, nothing's a done deal until Parliament's had its say on what Theresa May's proposing. And it looks as she can't even get the support of her own Tory MPs, the DUP, certainly not Labour, certainly not the Liberal Democrats. So, really, nothing's done until our Parliament's taken back control and had its say on it. It doesn't look too good, to say the least, for Theresa May's half-baked deal.
Do you think, I mean, Tony Blair said it was a dodo, do you think it's a dead duck, this thing? It's not going to get through Parliament under any circumstances?
Well, what Theresa May needs to do is wake up and smell the coffee, ditch this deal and come back with something better, something which can command the support of a majority of MPs. And I'd suggest that what she does is come back with the deal that Labour's proposed, then we can guarantee it will get through Parliament.
Surprise, surprise. But that's not going to happen, and it is too late to renegotiate something. It's been done. The EU have made it absolutely clear that they are not reopening this negotiation at this point. So Labour is now in the position. You vote this down, and you drive the country clearer and faster towards no deal. That's just logic. That's the English language. If there isn't a deal, there is no deal.
Well, one of the worst things that Theresa May and her government have done through this is, in effect, hold the country to ransom by telling two groups of people two different things at the same time. Theresa May has been telling people who voted Remain that the choice is either her half-baked deal or a disastrous no deal. And then she's telling people who voted Leave that the choice is between her half-baked deal and remaining in the European Union. Okay. In other words, no Brexit. Actually, there is, and I know this phrase is becoming more and more popular, there is a third way. And the third way is Labour's sensible, common-sense deal that can actually bring the country together.
Well, let's talk about something else that appears to be on the table. There's five cabinet ministers and quite a lot of Tory MPs beginning to rally behind the idea of Britain instead staying inside the EEA, the Norway-style arrangement. That's very, very close to what Labour wants as well. Presumably, in those circumstances, Labour would back it.
No, because the Norway arrangement doesn't meet our customs union test. Norway's not in a customs union.
So you vote everything down, really, wouldn't you? And the problem is, you say that, you know, you'd like a general election. A general election requires a lot of Tory MPs to vote for it. About 100 Tory MPs would have to vote in favour of an election in which their party was divided and had failed on Brexit. It's a very, very unlikely thing to imagine any party doing that. You might want it, but they're not going to give it to you.
Well, a lot of things have seemed unlikely in politics recently, and lots of the experts have got it wrong.
True.
The experts predicted the last EU referendum wrong. The experts said that Trump could never have been elected. I wish he hadn't have been. The experts said that Labour would be smashed at the last general election. We weren't. The experts said Jeremy Corbyn would never be elected as Prime Minister. I think the age of the experts is over. The age of political certainty is over. And, of course, we want to be in government as soon as possible, but we want to get the best deal for the country to bring people, both who voted Remain and who voted Leave, together. We think we can do that.
I never thought I'd hear Richard Burgon channeling Michael Gove, but there you go. Age of the experts is over. He'd have agreed with that. Nonetheless, Labour has a series of options in front of you. If you get your election, and you're right, anything might happen, you might get the election, Labour would presumably go into that election advocating Brexit. You'd go in wanting us to leave the EU in March next year.
Well, it depends when an election is. I mean, Labour's...
Well, let's assume it is quite quickly.
Well, we're in the age of hypotheticals here, or the era of hypotheticals, but let me say this. Labour, if we were in government now, would have negotiated and would be negotiating a deal to respect the result of the referendum and leave the EU on the basis of the common-sense Brexit arrangement that we've put forward. So if we're in government now, that's what we would be doing. We don't know when the next general election is going to be. We don't know what the state of things will be at that time.
I'm only asking you about it because that's what you say as a party you want to happen. If it doesn't happen, and I've suggested it's quite unlikely, if it doesn't happen, another thing on the table, as Tony Blair was describing, is another referendum on this. That is still something that is possible for Labour MPs to vote for in the end, isn't it?
Well, a second referendum isn't off the table. Our conference policy has made that clear. But there's a whole sequence of events to go before then. Sure. And we think the priority is trying to force the government to get a better deal, a deal that's in the national interests, a deal that has, crucially, a permanent customs union in it, a deal that, crucially, protects workers' rights, environmental protections and consumer protections and security.
As Richard Burgon, how would you vote in another referendum if remaining in the EU was on the table versus Brexit of some kind?
Well, there's lots of ifs. We don't know if there's going to be a second referendum.
But you must know what you feel about
this. We don't know when such a referendum, if it takes place, would take place. Would it take place before we left the EU? Would it take place after we left the EU? What I'll say is I'm happy to come back on this programme and discuss that in detail if we have a second referendum. But what we've got to focus on now is what's happening today and what's happening in the next 2 weeks. We're now reaching a point where Theresa May is trying to push through Parliament an ill-fated, half-baked deal that's the worst of all worlds. We need to work as hard as we can to ensure she thinks again and try and bring people together on the basis of a deal that works in the national interest. Because I'll say this...
Isn't the truth of this that you're trying to create as much of a crisis as possible to shatter the government, bring it down and get the election? But in doing that, you are risking the possibility of no deal.
No, we're totally opposed to no deal. And I go back again. I say it because it's true. We're going back to the point...
OK, so how are you going to stop it?
We're going back to the point where Theresa May and many commentators are posing a false choice to the country as if it's between Theresa May's dreadful deal and no deal, or whether it's between Theresa May's deal and no Brexit.
No,
there is another option.
I do understand that. I understand that. But nonetheless, what I'm still struggling with, the clock is ticking. This is an international agreement. At the end of March next year, we leave the EU unless something extraordinary intervenes. And when people say we're going to stop no deal, there's a majority of the Commons against no deal and all the rest of it. What is the mechanism which actually stops there being a no deal?
Well, amendments can be put down, motions can be put down.
No legal force. No legal force.
Well, there's a great political force to what the House of Commons decides, and I think that's very important, as people across the political divide have said, about making sure that our Parliament has its say, reasserting parliamentary sovereignty. It is meant to be about taking power back for our Parliament, after all.
In a world of ifs and maybes, Richard Burgon, thanks very much indeed for talking to us this morning. Now then, Jeremy Hunt, the Foreign Secretary, is with me now. Before we get on to the very important matter of Brexit, let me ask you about two British citizens, Mr. Hedges, for instance, to start with. You seem to be very, very angry about what the UAE did, as if you were personally betrayed by them.
Well, we were very shocked, I've met Daniela, his wife, who is being incredibly brave in very challenging circumstances. I am more optimistic as we sit here now that we can find a way through this. The UAE is a very long-standing friend of the UK, and I've had very good conversations with their foreign minister. I'm going to speak to him again this afternoon. So I'm very much hoping we can find a way through that.
Let me ask you then about Nazarin Zaghari Ratcliffe, who's in prison in Tehran, in Iran, has been there for a long time now. This goes back to 2016. Your predecessor, Boris Johnson, was heavily criticised for his role over this. Is there any grounds for optimism there?
Well, I think that's more challenging. I was in Tehran on Monday. I asked to meet Nazanin. I wasn't allowed to, but I did get to meet her daughter. In fact, she gave me a present from Nazanin, which is this doll that Nazanin made for my own daughter, who's also 4 years old, which was particularly difficult for Nazanin to make because she's now got numbness in her shoulder and in her hands.
And she made that before that happened?
I think she made it when it happened. And the daughter also did a picture of me with my four-year-old and her four-year-old, and she's put me in a bow tie, probably thinks I'm a Tory toff. Nothing escapes a four-year-old, but... I think the thing
what
about...
are you going to do about it, though? I mean, this is a very proud, prickly and difficult regime to deal with. They have been pretty icy about this so far. How are you going to shift things?
Well, I had two messages, and I spent a long time talking about Nazanin. And the first thing to say is that it's not just Nazanin. Nazanin has an incredibly brave husband, Richard Ratcliffe, who's decided to go public. But in most cases, the Iranians say, if you go public, the conditions in prison will be worse for your loved one. He ignored that.
Straightforward bullying threat.
And the truth is that there are other British citizens in the same situation as Nazanin, and there are other citizens from other countries. And my message to Iran was twofold. First of all, get the medical treatment to Nazanin that she needs. It's very, very important. And there's one other citizen whose name I'm not at liberty to disclose who also needs urgent medical treatment. Get him his medical treatment. And number two, Iran is one of the great civilizations of the Middle East. It wants to be a great regional power. If they want respect, then do not start locking up innocent people as a tool of diplomatic leverage. It is totally and utterly unacceptable.
Do you think they're listening to you?
I think they're listening. Whether they're going to do anything is a different matter. But Richard Ratcliffe, this time of year, every year, he launches a campaign to get Nazanin home for her birthday, which is the 26th of December. And I know we all want to support that campaign, but if she could come home, wouldn't that be the best Christmas present, not just for her, but for the whole country?
Let's turn to Brexit, if we could. Will this deal make us better off than where we are now?
Well, I think the truth is there are compromises in this deal. But my colleagues in the House of Commons will be looking at this and they will say that we have got between 70 and 80% of what we want. And the question is, can this be a staging post to getting 100% of what we want, particularly being an independent trading nation, a sovereign Britain, ploughing our furrow in the world? And
I'm thinking specifically, I'm sorry, of will we be financially, economically better off as a result of this deal as compared to staying inside the EU?
Well, I think there's a huge debate about the economic impact of Brexit.
Yep.
This deal, as it stands, mitigates most of the negative impacts.
So most of the negative impact means you think we will not be better off?
Well, I think we will not be significantly worse off or better off, but what it does mean is that we get our independence back, we get our sovereignty back, we get control of our borders, we're not making annual payments. But the question...
The government modelled various different outcomes, including leaving under WTO rules, which would reduce the size of the economy by 7.8% in terms of the growth that we would lose over 15 years, but didn't do that for Mrs. May's deal. And we were promised that once we knew the deal, what the deal was, and it's now been signed off, so we all do know that deal, the government would publish its modelling of what that would mean for us economically. Is that now going to happen?
Yes, it is. And we will explain those figures. But what people will see is that this deal has a range of potential outcomes because we haven't negotiated the future trading relationship in its entirety. But the point for my colleagues is that if we turn this deal down, it is not automatically the case that the Europeans will agree to negotiate a better deal. In fact, we heard Laura Koonsberg this morning saying that they are now being absolutely categoric that they won't. And you've got people like Tony Blair, who you were talking to earlier, who is waiting to say, if Parliament turns this down, look, the politicians can't agree, let's give it back to the people to decide. And that sounds very democratic. Of course, it would, be profoundly undemocratic for the reasons that you challenged him on, because the people have made their decision once and they don't want to go back and keep being asked the same thing over and over again.
What is a turkey trap?
Well, I'm not going to go into what I discussed in Cabinet, because those are confidential discussions.
But you recognise the phrase, or you wouldn't have said it.
Well, one of the things that wasn't leaked was what I said at the start of that Cabinet discussion, and I said that all of us around the Cabinet table need to recognise that Theresa May's job right now is perhaps one of the most difficult jobs of any Prime Minister or President in the Western world. And whatever our internal discussions, we owe her our loyalty. And I think that is important, and I think that's what the country wants as well.
The reason I would suggest that turkey trap is an important phrase that we should remember, it doesn't refer to Christmas, it refers to the country, is it's the state of being in a customs arrangement with the EU, out of which you can't get by yourself in either direction. In other words, your hands are tied, you're inside this agreement until the EU wants you out again. And that is a very, very difficult submissive position for a country to be in, and that is why an awful lot of your colleagues can't swallow this deal.
Well, that's why a lot of people are uncomfortable with the backstop. Indeed, Theresa May herself has said she's uncomfortable with some elements of the backstop. But the question we have to ask is, can this be the springboard through which we become an independent sovereign power negotiating our own trade deals? I think there is a degree of comfort in the wording in the political declaration, which states that as the endpoint. Now, that's only a political declaration. However, It is also effectively the negotiating mandate for the next stage of the discussions. And we know in the EU's case that that is very important because they tend to stick to their mandate. But what I would say is we can get there. There will be very tough negotiations, but it's possible. But there are also very big risks on the other side. If this deal is rejected, it's by no means certain as to what would happen.
I'll come on to those risks in just a second. How many Tory MPs do you think will vote against this?
Well, that's a very difficult question, and the arithmetic at the moment is looking challenging, but a lot can change over the next 2 weeks. But I think what all of my colleagues will be doing is thinking what is in the national interest, and they'll also be talking to their own constituents. And when I talk to my constituents, there's a lot of people, a friend of mine described them as bobs, and that's not Roberts, that's people who are bored of Brexit. They want us to get on with it and deliver Brexit.
It's a useful phrase, I would say.
There are also people who are not bored of Brexit, who are passionate about the details, who, like me, have run their own business. And what they say is, if you have a deal that gives you most of what you wanted, not all of it, you take it. And then you try at the next stage and negotiate the other bits that you couldn't get. And I think the thing people wouldn't forgive us for, if I could just make this point, Andrew, is if we got to the 30th of March next year and we hadn't left the EU or we hadn't put ourselves on a course to end free movement of people, which is the thing that mattered to most people. And so that's the uncertainty that we'd be risking.
That directly. Theresa May has said there are three options: my deal, leaving without a deal, or not having any kind of Brexit at all. That third option, no Brexit at all, how could we get to a situation which we didn't actually leave?
Well,
I don't understand what you meant by that.
Well, because you heard Tony Blair on the programme earlier making his case for a second referendum, and he would immediately say any kind of gridlock in Parliament means... but he would say any kind of gridlock. He told you what the logic was for a second referendum.
So when she says that we might not get Brexit out of this, what she is saying is that if my deal is voted down, the political chaos resulting from that might mean there would be a second referendum.
Well, what she's saying is that there will be a huge degree of uncertainty. And the truth is, no one really knows. There is one option, which I know some of my colleagues are hoping for, and Arlene Foster, speaking very powerfully this morning, was saying, which is to go back and get a better deal, perhaps which doesn't have the backstop. But there are other options that people will be pushing very hard for. Now, there's one thing that Tony Blair said, which I just want to use this chance, if I could, just to counter, because I think it was profoundly wrong. He said that only a second referendum would give social stability. Just imagine what happened if we had a second referendum and, as he hopes, the result was reversed. You would then have 48% of the country that had voted to leave twice, and they would be incredibly angry. That wouldn't be social stability. And in truth, leaving, but also having friendly trading relationships with you, and that's what Theresa May is trying to achieve.
Let's flip to the alternative, which is a no-deal Brexit. If MPs vote down this deal, is it inevitable that you go to a no-deal Brexit?
It's not inevitable, but the way the law is that legally we will leave the EU on the 29th of March, and there would need to be another Act of Parliament or an amendment to an Act of Parliament to change that.
You're an experienced parliamentarian. A motion by the House of Commons doesn't end no-deal, does it?
No, it doesn't.
And so, therefore, if this is voted down, the government's policy is that we are heading towards no deal, even though you say that would be catastrophic and chaotic.
It would be the case that that would be the option if Parliament did not change any Acts of Parliament.
Aren't you just holding a gun to the head of the British people, saying this deal or else we pull the trigger and we have absolute chaos?
No, far from that. What we're actually saying is that if there was gridlock in Parliament, there would be a huge degree of uncertainty. And what the British people want is they want us to get on and deliver Brexit. And let's remember in this deal, there are lots of things that any of us can point to that we don't like, there's also a huge amount that we've achieved, not just the ending of free movement of people, the ending of large annual payments, the coming out of the common fisheries policy, the common agricultural policy, largely ending the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice. So it gets us a lot of what we wanted, not everything, but the question is, can this be that staging post that gets us to the point where we could get everything? And I think with a lot of hard work, it can be.
See, Amber Rudd says that the House of Commons can prevent there being no deal.
Well, there are circumstances that probably, in order to do that, if it was a Conservative government, the House of Commons would have to bring down a Conservative government. So what you see is that if there was this gridlock, you'd have some people wanting a better Brexit deal, you'd have some people wanting a second referendum, you'd have Jeremy Corbyn wanting a Labour government, and all of this would be huge uncertainty.
In this incredibly complicated, uncertain situation, is it possible the government simply collapses?
It's not possible to rule out anything. And that's why all of us, what we have to do...
The government is possible at this stage.
What all of us have to do is to say, what do our constituents actually want in this situation? And we have to work out what's in the national interest. And it's all about the balance of risks, because this isn't a perfect deal for everyone, but it does have a lot of what everyone wants. And the question is whether we can use it to get everything we want. And the reasons, that will be difficult, but it's not impossible.
One of the reasons lots of people are very suspicious of this deal is a phrase used by Jeremy Corbyn, which is accurate. He called it a blind Brexit. And a blind Brexit, when you look at the vagueness of the political declaration, is absolutely fair.
Well, that is absolute nonsense. Well, but, I mean, he's leader of the opposition and he can say what he wants. But
I'm
the
not
truth
sure
is
it is nonsense. Can I just challenge you on that? Because Theresa May said it would be very, very detailed. The chairman of your party came on this programme, sat in that chair and said it would be a very, very specific and detailed agreement in the end. And when you look at something like trade in goods, absolutely central to all of this, what the political declaration says, the parties envisage having a trading relationship on goods that is as close as possible. What does that mean?
Well, it says
as close
some...
As it means nothing.
There are some bits, of course, that there are to be negotiated, but there are other things that are very clear. No tariffs. No quantitative limits on the amount of goods that are exported and imported. Becoming an independent coastal state.
Negotiating
access to our waters in the way that Iceland and Norway does. These are very concrete
these
details.
These are left for the future. These things are left for the future.
No,
and again,
sorry,
on border
Andrew,
checks.
Sorry, I need to correct you. The things I've just talked about are not left for the future. It's agreed
fishing,
that we will not have tariffs.
About.
It's agreed that we will not have limits on the amount of goods that are exported or imported. There's a lot of detail in that. But it is a mandate
phrase,
for negotiations.
Okay,
it
that very alluring phrase, frictionless trade, which was in the Chequers Agreement, which you signed up to, has vanished.
Well, frictionless trade is possible in that agreement. But what the agreement says is the degree to which
it's
trade...
It's possible, but it's not
well,
there.
The degree to which trade is frictionless... will depend on the amount of level playing field terms and conditions that we agree to. And that's what would be the case in any trade.
OK, border checks, very important to people. The parties envisage a spectrum of different outcomes. That literally means anything might happen.
Because this is a trade deal that we will negotiate, but this is the key point, Andrew.
It's
hang on.
It's so vague.
Andrew, this is the key point, that legally we can only negotiate a trade deal once we have left the EU. Now, the withdrawal agreement, which is a legally binding document, means that we can leave the EU on the 29th of March, restore control of our borders, stop big annual payments, largely remove the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice,
and then we
can negotiate the trade deal, which gets us, with a lot of hard work, all the things that we want.
If we end up in the backstop, and as you say, this is all legal, so we might very well end up in the backstop and be unable to stop that happening, we have no independent way out of that. Do we?
That is why a lot of people are uncomfortable with the backstop. But also, look at what that political declaration says, not in vague terms, but very, very clearly, that Britain will be an independent trading nation. And so there it is in black and white. That is the intention of the EU, and that is our intention, of course, as well.
If Theresa May loses this absolutely crucial vote on which she has staked her entire premiership in the House of Commons, can she stay on as Prime Minister?
Absolutely she can.
Really?
And I don't think in a day when she is in Brussels battling for Britain with 27 other European leaders, we should be making her position weaker by speculating about her future. And I think people have underestimated her in the past a lot.
Final question. It has been suggested that if MPs reject this deal, it could be brought back to the House of Commons later, perhaps after a collapse in the markets and a general sense of national crisis. Will MPs get more than one chance to vote on the withdrawal agreement, or is this it?
Well, we don't know the answer to that question, but what I would say is...
It could come back a second
time. But what I would say is, instead of all this looking into the abyss, I think we also need to have a little bit of self-confidence and optimism. We have been in situations far, far more challenging than this as a country. We're going to get through this. We're going to get to the other side, give people the Brexit they voted for, and help people to feel proud in the great country that we are.
All right. Jeremy Hunt, thanks very much indeed for talking to us. Before the end of the programme, let's just head off to Brussels once more and our Brussels correspondent, Adam Fleming, for the latest. Adam.
Morning, Andrew. Well, the EU27 leaders arrived this morning all with the same script. Number one, Theresa May's been a good negotiator and she's got a good deal. Number two, this is the only deal on offer. It will not be reopened. But the spell was broken by the president of Lithuania, a formidable woman called Dalia, who revealed what they're thinking in private. They are worried that there could be another referendum in the UK, the deal could be rejected, there could be a general election, or Theresa May could be back here trying to renegotiate it, a situation they do not want. The 27 leaders met without Mrs. May first this morning. They rubber-stamped this deal, which has taken 525 days to negotiate, in less than 40 minutes. Then Mrs. May was ushered in to say her piece. They're still discussing it with her now, but the summit will end in a couple of minutes' time. Then we'll hear some parting words from the President of the European Council, Donald Tusk, the President of the European Commission, Jean-Claude Juncker, and as far as Brussels is concerned, their part in this drama is effectively over. The deal is handed to Theresa May to sell to the British public and to sell to a very sceptical British Parliament.
And very briefly, Adam, if the Commons tears this to pieces in due course and the deal falls, how many other European countries want to reopen the deal and add in things that are not in it from their point of view, on fishing and Gibraltar and all the rest of it?
Well, it's hard to give you an exact number, but if the last 10 days of this process has taught us anything, national interests really come into play when there's an opportunity for them to come into play. So stand by.
Adam, thanks very much indeed. And thanks to all my guests today. We'll be back here on BBC One next Sunday when I'm going to be joined by the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby. But for now, we leave you with music from The Good, The Bad and The Queen, a supergroup fronted by Paul Simonon and Damon Albarn, described by some critics as the album of the year from Maryland. This is Drifters and Trawlers. Goodbye.
I've done enough today, sweet Lord, I've done enough today. I've seen the jetsam rise and fall, 'cause they got them all, they were trawling down at the bottom where every fin ends, and the lovers I have lost have gone. I've seen the jetsam rise and fall, singing back to the sand, run ashore, fixed odds, and with little care I shall go into town in the devil's name alone. And the land is dark still. Throw away your fears, throw away the nets, and throw away the past. When it's taken you half of the day to get over the waves you have cast. Today, sweet Lord, I've done enough today. I've seen the jetsam rise.
You've been cleared to work in intelligence. You'll be working for Major Wilson.
You do know I'm in...